Hey, well, good morning. You've already had some drama, so I'll try not to add to that with more messages or jokes about fire alarms. But I couldn't help, as I was thinking about today's topic, reflect on an analogy that some very distinguished McKinsey colleagues some time ago came up with. In fact, I think it's one of them may actually be here, that's Dick Foster. And the conversation they started was really quite appropriate because around creative destruction. And since we are at the CDL, I thought there was some real value because I see a parallel with what's happening in machine intelligence, or AI as I'll refer to it, but machine intelligence more generally. I want to give full credit to them for this analogy, but I put a Scottish twist on it because I'm from Scotland and I was born in Ottawa, so I think of myself as sort of Canadian. And the analogy is with the steamship and the rise of the steamship and how the clipper liners, the sailboats, responded to the challenge of steam. Some of you may have seen this before, but I can't help but think, for all the optimism that's no doubt out there, for all the scale of opportunity you can all see, the reality is this is how a lot of people are reacting. So this is the SS Savannah, 1818, the first steam vessel to traverse the Atlantic, although it didn't really do so, because as you can see here, there's one little chimney and there's two large sails, and I think it was under steam power for all of about 9 hours on a journey that took somewhere around 34 days. So hardly a breakthrough in technology. But this, of course, is the response. 50 years later, we have the Glenavon, a fine vessel, three masts. Looks pretty impressive. Technology hasn't quite got there, so it's still holding its own. But it's at this point the steamship starts to really bite into the market, and the technology is coming of age. So how do you respond? This is how you respond. The Prussian, a fine bit of German engineering. Five masts. A wonderful vessel. But the problem? The technology has just moved on. Here's Scotland's fight. It's the SS Grampian, built in Glasgow. We're very proud of this vessel. A real steamship, although you'll notice there's still a couple of sails on it, just in case, front and back. So we're still hedging our bets on the technology. But if you're a clipper owner, a sailboat owner, you know you've got this vessel still licked. You can still compete, because you do this. The Thomas Larsen. Seven sails. You just keep adding to the boat. Now, there is a problem with the Thomas Larsen. It's called wind. When the winds came up on Friday, December the 13th, I kid you not, Friday, December the 13th, 1907, the Captain Turner, who was steering the Thomas Larsen, no longer found he could steer this fine vessel. And it ran aground in the Scilly Islands with the loss of all the crew except for one individual. Captain of the ship, Captain Turner, survived, but it was the death of sail and an era had gone. The captain lived to tell the tale. Now, I think we're actually facing something somewhat similar. A lot of denial around the pace and scale of what's happening. A sense that just because it hasn't been adopted today, we don't necessarily need to move. So I want to give rise to those voices, because I suspect we've got a lot of optimists in this room. I suspect we've got a lot of people who believe. I believe. But I also recognize that a lot of CEOs who have to make investment decisions are asking, when will I actually see a return from all this great rhetoric? And that's the subject that I would like to hear us go on. The potential economic impact enormous. Winners and losers. We have people already who are winners and losers, both in terms of countries and in terms of sectors. So a lot's already happening. But the reality is, for adoption at scale, some things need to change. Because that's not where we are today. First and foremost, the differences in the pace at which adoption is occurring are significant. And I'm actually going to talk about absorption as opposed to adoption. I'll just spend 1 minute on that because it's sort of important. You could look at the pace at which any one technology under the broad banner of machine intelligence is adopted. So things like computer vision, natural language processing, virtual assistants and agents, robotics and automation, and of course machine intelligence, machine learning itself, sorry, machine learning. Any one of those five, you can probably ask, add autonomous vehicles and so on to it. Any one of those being adopted is fine, but what I'm really looking at here is five at least being adopted. So significant adoption, we call that absorption. But if you use that as the metric, and we've been modeling out how we fit today's trends with some sense of how they could unfold in the future, we think this is the picture that you'll get for the two leaders, China and the United States. The gap will remain. The United States will still be ahead. Roughly over half its companies will indeed have adopted all five of these technologies and applied them in some way. China will be up at 40%. There will be leaders, though. South Korea and Sweden are on a path to pass both those geographies. And there will be real laggards. economies with only moderate foundations. So Italy and Brazil. Italy is doing its best, by the way, to sink these numbers even lower, if you saw the news this morning. And if you go further afield, we have other countries that really are going to be left behind. Why does this matter? Because the gap is growing. 11 percentage points, 2023, if you put that forward, 23 percentage points. When you talk about a digital divide, the okay machine intelligence divide. And that divide has real implications for the world in terms of countries that will be left behind. If we actually just put that in a more dramatic sense, if you look at the leader Sweden and the laggard Zambia, that gap's enormous and will have a real impact on how the difference between so-called developed countries and those that are emerging, how that gap could actually grow. So this is real political, geopolitical impact. Indeed, if you actually look at how important what we are discussing today is to these economies, just take the developed markets. If you look at the x-axis, that's the sort of reasonable forecast one could have for GDP growth in those geographies. So you'd expect the US, maybe above this at the moment, to be somewhere around 200 basis points of GDP growth. AI, your machine intelligence, AI, if you take those five areas, in and of itself, should add about 1.5 or 150 basis points to GDP. So you can, another way of looking at it is, this is pretty much most of the United States GDP growth. In some countries, it's actually all the GDP growth. So this is hugely important to the economic development of these countries. Of course, there are other factors, so it's a trite analogy, but it does show the scale of what we're talking about this morning. And if you're a developing market, less so, partly because the underlying demographic and other forces driving growth, but you cannot afford to lose this, and there's a real risk you will. So this matters. This matters, and the potential is enormous. These numbers are huge. Why are we seeing winners and losers emerging? Well, let's just start with the reality that that is what is occurring today. And if we have a look, the reality is the United States and China are dominating this landscape, and Europe is falling further and further behind. Now, I will not hazard a guess about my own country of Canada. I'll leave that to you. But we'll talk about Canada later. And look at the most vibrant hubs, just measured by activity, investment dollars. I'll pick some numbers in this in a moment. Whether it's Silicon Valley, Boston, or New York, they are dominating the agenda, certainly south of the border here. And if we take China, Beijing, and Shenzhen, you've probably seen one of my colleagues put an article out yesterday, about 40% of the world's robots are already in Shenzhen. So the reality is this landscape is being played out, and sadly there's really only one hub at any scale in Europe. At the moment that may change, obviously. There are things happening there that may cause it to change, but the reality is this is a landscape that's dominated by two geographies, China and the United States, and the others are playing catch-up, or frankly, just falling behind and not catching up at all. So, what's happening in terms of where the money is going? Well, this is a look at the external dollars, because I'm going to make the point, and it's fitting that Michael will follow me to talk about Ali. Most of the dollars actually going into this space have been put in by technology giants through their own funding. That's where the real action is. But let's look at the external dollars. The dollars coming from outside the technology players. These are the five areas, or six areas, I think I added in autonomous vehicles here. If you look at these six spaces, you can see the kind of money that is flowing. Overwhelmingly, machine learning is the great enabler. It's attracting the biggest amount of investment dollars. That's pretty predictable, given its role in the overall economy. But computer vision, attracting a fair amount of money, and the rest, relatively modest sums. But the money is flowing, and this is where it's flowing to. But that dollar amount is dwarfed by the amount that the technology giants are investing on their own accord. They've raised those funds, and they are disposing funds that essentially aren't externally raised. But if you look at how they are generating spending, it's internal corporate investment, whether it's the technology giants or other corporates playing in the space, far greater than the external funding, far greater than the VC funding, the PE funding, or D&M in this area. This is really a game being played out amongst technology giants, whether they're behind the Great Firewall in China or they're playing out in the West. So that's where the dollar is coming from. And sometimes we don't see it that way, but it is important to understand this is an inside baseball game, to use the American analogy. That investment is also moving, and it's moving heavily to the Americas and to Asia. Americas and Asia, that's where the dollars are really flowing. It used to be largely all to the US. You can see that Asia is catching up. The Europeans do have money coming in, but their issue is they don't have the technology giants to fund that money. There's only one technology giant amongst the Europeans that makes the top 20, and that's SAP. So the dollars that are being spent internally aren't coming in Europe, but that's why the gap is growing, which is a significant issue for the European markets. In the North Americas and the Asians, that's where the money is. So as the investment shifts to those geographies, we also need to understand what's driving all of this, and then how does that translate into different sectors of the economy? So that's what I'd like to turn to now. First of all, at the geographic level, what's driving it is the underlying AI infrastructure, whether it's the amount of investment, which I just showed is very heavily weighted to the United States and to China, or for that matter, the research and the activities that relate to research, that's more broadly based. And indeed, the productivity boost that automation can bring simply because of the readiness and availability of the industries that will benefit. And that plays to the Western countries more than to China at this stage. There are a series of enablers, and again, those play particularly to the large geographies in the West. Whether it's digital absorption, so they already pick up on the digital side, the incentive to innovation is occurring, the availability of human capital, which is the great constraint, I'll talk about that later, and the extent to which the economies are connected. You put all that together, and this is the picture that emerges. We have four economies that have the underlying wherewithal and infrastructure to support the rapid development of the AI infrastructure. So, where are we? Are we at a tipping point or not? I heard some of that conversation going on earlier. And this is why a number of CEOs are getting frustrated, because they've been sold this story before. IT is going to change the world, you get this return, just hang in there, it's coming. And maybe it is. I believe it is. But I also think we need the right frame, and we need the right perspective and timing. So we had a look at when you can realistically expect a tipping point. If you take 2018 as a starting point, you can see in this chart, somewhere around in 2025, 26, 27, you start to see the combination of network and scale effects coming in, and the curve starts kicking up. But it's still a relatively slow curve. And that matters, because one of the things that I think is happening is expectations at the moment may be ahead of the reality. Now, I say that, but I'm always reminded that we tend to overstate the near-term and understate the long-term impact of technology. In other words, we always overstate what could happen in the next couple of years and way underestimate what could happen in the next decade. And that may be what's going to occur here, but it is the next decade, it's not the next couple of years. So I'm really excited about all the stuff in the next couple of years. But most business leaders are faced with the reality that says, how do we invest in over a decade? And I think our modeling supports that question. Put it another way, it's about 10 years before we reach the kind of penetration that digital enjoys today. So if we look at digital technologies, and digital technology curves have evolved roughly the same sort of decade, however you model it comes out. So we're about 10 years away from a true tipping point where this becomes not ubiquitous, but enjoyed by 40% or so of the companies that have access to this technology in the first place. One key point, the digital factor in this is obviously significant. This chart simply looks at different sectors of the economy. The darker the blue, the more that they're already digitized. And as we look at them, there really is a relationship. The heavily digitized sectors are going to be the ones that get and adopt machine intelligence more rapidly and with more conviction than those that are not. And you can sort of see that play through. High-tech and telecommunications, no surprise. Automotive and assembly with automation. Clearly, financial services already happening. I'm sure Mark will talk about that. Resources and utilities and so on. You can find the page, and you can see that the top of the page is where the action is more likely to take place. So those are the sectors that will really drive the adoption curve. That's another way of looking at it. If we actually look at where they are and we look at the current rate of adoption and how that demand trajectory is unfolding, you can see we already get heavy demand from high tech, no surprise, financial services, as I said, and then there's a real gap down to things like automotive and assembly, energy, media and entertainment, where there's demand, but it's modest, and where the adoption levels are already reasonable. So this is just a sense of how the geographic picture then translates into what's happening within industry and sectors. But here's the thing, and why I'm a believer. I'm sure we'll have lots of examples, and we believe the examples will tell the tale or the use cases. Of course, the reason we're all here is because we believe this stuff matters, and we do allow the world to do things it couldn't do before, and we agree with that. If you look at the opportunity that exists, one way of looking at it is, you can use techniques to do a number of things that could be broken through AI. Do you have to use it? Well, 15% of the cases, no. We've just published a report looking at the application of AI technologies. I have to go into that in the panel discussion. But you can get full value without using sophisticated AI techniques in only about 15%. There's another 16% that you sort of need it. But the reality is, in most of the areas that we've been looking at, you really need to adopt one of the five technologies I was describing if you're going to break through. And that's ultimately why the message to a CEO is, yes, manage your expectations, but there is real value here and that value is coming. It just may not come as quickly as some say. So, what needs to change? What needs to change to capture that value? The story is good, there's lots of opportunity, but we can see that tipping point is not quite there. And I think in a way it's a classic change management challenge, similar to the challenge that digital economies are facing. First of all, you've got to demonstrate the success stories. Hopefully there'll be lots of those today. Examples of where the technology itself has brought real economic value, real impact, real change. Secondly, we need the data ecosystems. They're not perfect. Happy to talk about that also. But the data systems have to be there. We need techniques and tools that people can actually use, not just sophisticated, complicated, and hard to understand, but real techniques, real tools that can be accessed more generally. This needs to fit into the workplace. That's a big order. A lot of this stuff just doesn't fit into the workplace yet. And then it's a whole organizational challenge. How do you get people to adopt and embrace change? That's a long story and one we'll happily talk about for quite some time. But you could argue that's actually going to be the biggest barrier and the one we'll get to last. It's the one holding up most technology adoption. And there's no reason to believe it'll be different with machine intelligence. That means the following. Seven obstacles that need to be overcome. First of all, we've got to have the data sets. I suspect we'll get there. Those data sets will appear, and we'll work hard on those. The harder part, explain what on earth we found. I'm sure you never sit through a presentation and do anything other than crystal clear and really get it. I'm not a technologist by background. But a lot of people have that issue. We've got to find a way to explain what we're seeing. Thirdly, there's bias. There's just bias in the data and the algorithms because they've been produced for another purpose. Let's recognize that bias. Because the moment a business leader sees that, it doesn't like the answer. It sets back programs at great scale. Capturing learnings. This is actually a place where I think there's going to have to be a real need to capture learnings across competition. This will be a place where actually people need to understand what's happening in the market. Organizational challenges, I touched on that. The business case remains elusive. That's a polite way of saying the numbers don't add up. Numbers don't add up at the moment, but somehow they have to. Business is pretty cynical. Numbers need to add up. And lastly, small matter of GDPR and various other regulatory hurdles coming in, which will play out differentially in different parts of the world with different attitudes to data sharing. But that's probably the biggest obstacle outside the internal organizational obstacle that I hear people asking about. It sounds great, but will we ever be able to do any of this? Some obstacles. What does that mean? Well, here's the thing. There is actually a first mover advantage here. So all those tech companies driving investment dollars are onto something. And I haven't spent time on that this morning, but there is a first mover advantage. We've looked at the rate at which adoption will proliferate. And so there does need to be a strategy, but that strategy has to at least be grounded in some sense of economic reality. Secondly, it's important that the initiative is prioritized by the top team of senior management. If this just becomes a hobby in R&D or R&I, it will not progress. And we've seen that happen too often. This needs to be a portfolio where people understand the range of initiatives and some just will not deliver. The culture needs to understand what to do with the data and to recognize the real regulatory issues around that data. Talent, huge shortage. I don't need to tell you that, that issue, but that is a real issue. Talent that can do two things. One, deeply technical, but two, translate that technical finding into real information that can be understood more generally. And finally, it matters where in the world you're based. If you're in China, the rules are a little different than if you're in the US, which is a little different than if you're in Canada, and so on. I think it is important to understand the environment, how that will shape the strategy you choose to apply. As we talk to technology providers, I think the question I sometimes wonder about is, have you really got a solution to a problem? Or have you just searched for a solution that you don't actually have a problem to solve? It sounds good. We need to focus on the big problems. And if you look at the sectors where this is going to have most impact, let's think about what their needs are first. And where the value will actually come, because that business case has to be better than it is today. And that needs to be applied to the investment portfolio. For policymakers, what we do matters. And I know there's some in this room, this market can get killed or at least curtailed very easily. And I think that's perfectly appropriate. Democracies can decide where to draw those lines. But it is important to understand the second order effects of some of the regulations that are already going on. And therefore, research dollars and investment funding does need to be put in place. But so too, I think there's research into how the social impact and the regulatory impact come together and fundamentally shape this market. So my message to you is, the SS Grampian was a fine vessel. The only problem, the Savannah was in 1818 and the Grampian was in 1907. I'm not going to be around that long, nor are you. So it'd be really good if we could fix this sooner rather than later. Thanks very much.